John, thank you so much for being with us.
Well, thank you. Nice to be here.
So the enormity of your job is just mind-boggling. I mean, how do you keep a collection like that safe and secure?
I had a lot of help. I had over 600 security staff in the department, and had a great management team of 8 managers who helped me sort of manage that program.
There were no major heists under your watch, but there were a few items that did go missing over the years. Can you tell us about some of those?
Well, I first got there in 1978. About a year later, 1979, we got a call that a Greek head was missing from one of the pedestals.
Head. Okay. Yeah.
And at first, we thought maybe it was, you know, misplaced, or, you know, a curator took it into conservation or something. But when we got down to the area, we saw it was taken right off its pedestal, and the wood was splintered, and we said we had a problem. We were able to recover it 5 days later on Valentine's Day, which was interesting, because when the Met received the object in an acquisition, there was a heart carved over its left eye. Hmm. And when we recovered it, there was another heart carved over its right eye, and it was in a locker in Grand Central Station. An anonymous call told us to go look for it. The police went to look for it, and they returned it to us. No one was ever arrested. It's interesting, with our thefts, you really are concentrating on getting the art back, recovering the art, as opposed to finding out who did it. The art becomes paramount, not the perpetrator.
Speaking of the perpetrators, I mean, who steals art? Is it usually an inside job? Is it somebody from the outside?
Yeah, well, I come to the conclusion there's 3 different types of art theft. And the word opportunity is important, because we have the internal opportunist, somebody who works within an institution or in someone's home who has opportunity to take an art object. We have a person who maybe comes in from the outside, construction worker, a visitor, who sees an opportunity to take a piece of art. And then we have the professional, or a person who is looking for something to steal and who has fences and ways to dispose of these art objects illegally.
You write in the book, a lot of your job was not just dealing with objects going missing, but you also had to deal with some interesting objects that showed up at the museum. Yeah. Can you tell us about some of those?
Yeah, there was this phenomena that's still probably going on today, where artists want to be in the museum. So from time to time, we've had people leave paintings at the information desk. We've had graffiti artists like Banksy put things on the wall. And we had 2 shrunken heads that were mailed to the museum, and they wanted to, you know, give them to the curator. And it was quickly decided that they didn't want them.
They didn't want the shrunken heads.
They didn't want the shrunken heads.
What did you do with the shrunken heads?
Well, we didn't know what to do with them. That's what the problem was. So we called the police department. They didn't feel there was any crime committed, so they told us, why don't you call the morgue? And that's what we did. We called the morgue, and they accepted them. And what they did with them, I don't know.
You write about another crime of opportunity in the book, when a ring was stolen. Talk about that one.
Yeah, here we're talking about 2 teenagers who come visiting the Met, and they were very innovative and very smart in the sense that they saw an opportunity. We had a weakness in our security where there was a split in the case, the glass case. They were able to come up with this idea where they got a coat hanger. They put it in the crack. There was a ring right at the crack.
What kind of ring was it?
It was a pharaoh's ring, a Ramses VI ring of pharaoh, gold. What they did is they, from the information desk, they got a floor plan. And on the floor, there was a 2-inch gap where they slid the floor plan under the glass case, knocked the ring off with the hanger, fell right onto the floor plan. They took it out. At the time, there were no cameras. This is 1980. There were no cameras. There was just a security officer patrolling. When the young man was interviewed, he said, we asked, why did you, you know, what did you do with the ring after you got it? And he said, I put it in my mouth because I didn't want to be searched as I left the museum. Not well planned, because as they were walking out of the museum, they just hit the first jewelry shop on Lexington Avenue, not far away from the museum, and sold it to the proprietor at the jewelry shop. That whole thing within, I think, 9 days was solved. The, you know, people who stole the ring and the recovery. So we, that's a home run in our business.
Great.
Yeah.
You got
yeah.
the art and the perpetrators.
And the perpetrator, right.
You talk about how there were no security cameras in the museum when you first started. I mean, that's obviously changed. Can you talk a little bit more about just how much technology changed during your tenure at the museum
oh,
and
sure.
how it helped you do your job?
Yeah, when I first, in the late 70s, early 80s, there were no cameras. In the late 80s, 90s, they started to have time lapse, they called, on video recording, which meant that the camera would switch to different places, so you could miss a lot of things that are going on. And then around 2004, we went into the network video, which we have today. And the museum is fully covered with, I don't want to give the exact number, but more than enough cameras to cover all the areas. It's helped in two areas. It's helped as a deterrent, mm-hmm. because a lot of these people know they're being taped. So you lessen that opportunity there. And if something does happen, you have something to investigate.
John Barelli, author of Stealing the Show, thank you so much for joining us.
Okay, thank you, Megan.